By thinking, we order the tapestry of impressions into objects, wholenesses, whose parts are all related to the whole and to the other parts in ways that must be understood out of the wholeness to which they belong. Faced by a sensory sequence, our thinking fashions a bird in flight. The time wholeness enwraps the object wholeness or shape wholeness. The universal concept bird, along with other concepts, is individualized to a picture, thanks to the anchoring support of the perception. The cognitive concept must be individualized by the object. The resulting mental representation must be inspected critically with a view to how much it is stamped by the object and how much it is stamped by the subject. Individual human capacities develop not out of bodily processes. They do develop in connection with the body, but by the suppression of the body. The soul enters a connection with something spiritual in the outer world, something that by its very essence can have nothing to do with our material bodily predisposition. This seems to contradict the obvious phenomena of heredity. We inherit not abilities, but a body that offers less resistance to the development of certain abilities. In cognition, we change our spirit. In developing abilities, we change our body as well. We make it better or worse. Cognitive mental pictures are fixed by the object, that is, individualized in keeping with reality. They can then be remembered and constitute our cognitive experience. And cognition becomes in turn the teacher of our action. From life experiences arise abilities. These emancipate themselves from the remembrance of experience. They sprout when the sheath of past experiences falls away. They retain only the capacity of individualizing, that is, the capacity of bringing forth from the region of universal concepts, mental pictures, not of past experiences, but of future deeds. These, the moral mental pictures, are not fixed by the object, but by the subject. They arise through free individualizing, when the practice material of supported individualizing is forgotten. That is the value of incarnating. It brings possibilities of individualizing our spiritual being. An unbiased look at how different people's qualities and capacities are leaves no doubt that people begin life not as blank slates, but as pre-imprinted individualities. Each child already comes with gifts, abilities pre-formed and suited to its theater of life. The question of immortality is closely connected with the question of existence before conception and birth. What gifts and individual character does a child bring along, and not merely receive from parents and environment? Why is this child born to these particular parents? Contemporary mainstream explanations likewise see the preformed human abilities as effects whose causes lie not in the influences of the present environment, but in a previous connection of the ancestors pictured as their bearer with comparable environmental influences. In his book Theosophy, Rudolf Steiner distinguishes individual differentness from differentness acquired only by individuality. The one kind of differences is common to all beings of nature. It comes from the varying influences of their environments. The other kind, the differences that are only acquired by individuality, are those an individual gives to himself. Their origin is the individual himself. This requires that he be an I being. And it is these that spin the golden thread in any human biography, even the most seemingly insignificant. The changes we give to ourselves stand in decisive contrast to those that come from without, and to all that is inherited. They arise from self-education. And yet, such genuinely individual abilities show themselves from birth. Now, the human abilities arise from our activity of individualizing, which can only be practiced against a body. That is, the ones we are born with come from a previous connection with a body. They open to unbiased scientific observation the reality of reincarnation. Man can only be comprehended as an eternal individuality who, in changing bodily vestments, passes through repeated courses of life. A single incarnation is but an example of the human individuality in question. Francesco Redi proved, at some personal risk, just imagine, back in the 17th century, you had to be careful not to contradict officially accepted views. He proved, omne vivum ex vivo, everything living comes from the living. Flies are not generated spontaneously from rotting matter. Anthroposophy discovers everything that is of the nature of soul comes from soul. It is not generated spontaneously from brain processes. And just as we are not simply beginners at birth, we are also unfinished at death. Do I simply identify myself with my body? The I who says yes to this will certainly cease to exist at death? Or do I shun my body? Or can I make use of it as an instrument? Our experiences with regard to these questions will determine our relation to the question of immortality, and not only theoretically. We live in smaller and greater rhythms of in-breathing and out-breathing, waking and sleep, birth and death. And so does even the earth itself. It is all part of one great breath, the enterprise man. This results in our twofold relation to the world, receiving and giving, suffering in the broader sense of the word, and acting. An example of receiving. In 1892, Max Joseph von Pettenkofer, who didn't believe bacteria simply caused illness, engaged in self-experimentation to prove it. He drank a large culture of cholera bacterium, personally brewed for him by his opponent Robert Koch, before several witnesses. Koch had objected in advance that von Pettenkofer's stomach acid could kill the germs, so he first took bicarbonate of soda to neutralize it. He showed only mild symptoms during the following week. Others, who anxiously seek to avoid any chance of infection, are nevertheless infected upon the least occasion. That is, we have a constitutional predisposition, a resonance with certain processes in the world. The other events pass us by unnoticed. A banker, for example, moves to a different continent. Soon he is again surrounded by bank things. An adopted child encounters experiences quite different from those of the rest of the adopting family. And as for the giving side, the deeds, they correspond to memory, but turned inside out. That is, the world bears a stamp from previous encounters with us. A relation remains between our inner being and the effects of our deed in the world. What is thus related to us comes to meet us from the world. It is called destiny. That means there is a destination. There is a sending. The experience is addressed to us. And conversely, we send our spirit into the world when we develop our abilities. That creates new destiny. In other words, there is a spirit that holds sway in world and man, uniting world and man. This spirit is called the Lord of Karma. Destiny enriches us by the fullness of experiences and challenges, from whose school we emerge as masters, masters of ourselves. All experiences, if we but ask them to show us their character as destiny, offer occasions for developing our genuine identity, our own spiritual being. Remains unshakably joined with the spiritual ground of the world, as long as we do not betray ourselves. The human spirit does not find the way to its evolutionary goal, freeness in community with others, in one incarnation alone. It needs the deeds and sufferings of repeated courses of life. The perceptions our bodies mediate confront us with the experience, all of this I am not. Our destinies offer the experience, all of this I am. you encounter yourself in life, really. Rudolf Steiner uses the example, I myself dropped that brick on my head. That is, my peripheral higher self did, my true being, expressed before birth in the spherical embryonic sheath. The body mediates experiences. The soul retains them as memories. The spirit enhances the memories to insights and abilities. The abilities work back upon the bodily world, including our own body. The experiences in bodily incarnation pass. The insights and abilities of the spirit abide. The world has been changed by our deeds. The effects of the deeds in the world and what the spirit has learned correspond, since both share a common origin, namely, the events of our previous life on Earth. Hence, the reincarnating spirit finds imprints in the world that resonate with his own imprints. In other words, we learn in order to understand the world and in order to work in the world. And both of these help us learn more and more to love. The Lord of Karma is in the great school of our life, the teacher of love. Sometimes it can feel more like wrath. Whether it is experienced as wrath or as love depends on our subjective awareness. We do learn most from painful experiences, if we but bear them with a will to learn. Resting in the womb of the future are the good and the bad lots for my soul. The good that flows to me daily, I will notice. It shows me what gods have made of me. The bad that sometimes flows to me, I will endure. It shows me what I can make of myself as yet. I have my good destiny to thank for how I live now. I have my strength in bad destiny to thank for the force that can lead me upward in life. Whoever supposes that good destiny only furthers us, bad only stoops us, sees not the year, but only the day.